Welcome to the channel. It's Dr. Durst. If you are new to the channel, then welcome, and I hope you like the content that I'm putting out. I am a traditionally trained physician that now specializes in regenerative medicine and sexual medicine. And so today I wanted to talk about something that we deal with on a daily basis in our office, and that's testosterone and hormones. And so just testosterone in general and how it's metabolized. And I've done a previous video if you like more of a visual aid, and it had a PowerPoint with it, but I'm just going to talk through it like I do with patients every day, especially if you're just listening on a podcast and don't have a video in front of you. So testosterone is a hormone that is needed by both men and for women. And so it is not thought to be a hormone for women, but it is the most abundant circulating hormone in a woman's body. It's just 10 times higher than that in the man, and it's the primary sex hormone in a man. But the metabolism is the same with some little differences, but we want to look at the entire picture when we're treating a patient with any hormones. And this video is going to be focused on testosterone and the key points that you would want to know and your provider would want to know when they're treating you with testosterone. But when we give testosterone, we want it to stay testosterone, but it converts in the body. And so when it converts, there is a pathway to dihydrotestosterone, which is a stronger metabolite of testosterone. It's 10 times stronger. And again, potentially could be affiliated with hair loss or hair growth or acne. So some of those side effects that you may get if you're a woman or even a man. And of course, hair thinning is never a good thing for men or for women. So that's an unacceptable potential side effect. So there are things that we can do to limit that activity of the stronger metabolite or even decrease the conversion. And that conversion from testosterone to dihydrotestosterone is done by 5 alpha reductase, the enzyme. So the other metabolism pathway for testosterone is to estrogen. And so with that, it's an aromatase enzyme that converts testosterone to estrogen. And so that is another level that we want to look at when we're treating men. And frequently we end up with men in the office and their estrogen really hasn't been looked at. But just like we think of estrogen as a female hormone, it is also necessary for a man. And so some men like that estrogen on slightly the higher end of the range, and they feel better with that from an energy standpoint, sex drive, or even sexual function. And so these are things that we want to look at with every single patient because it's customized to you. And so those metabolism pathways and those metabolites matter, but also there's a sex hormone binding globulin that's in the blood and will bind sex hormones. And so it can bind testosterone. And so you want to know that percent that is free. And so the percent free, we typically want to be about 2% at least. And so sometimes the total testosterone level needs to be adjusted to get that percentage of testosterone to be the free percentage to be higher so that the symptoms and symptom control is better. And so these are all little pieces that we want to know about testosterone and testosterone metabolism in the body. And of course, if somebody comes with a very low testosterone or they're very young and a low testosterone, then we also want to look at other hormones such as prolactin to make sure there's not an issue, something in the brain going on that potentially in the pituitary that can be an issue. And also there's LH and FSH, which come from the brain and stimulate the gonads, ovaries in a woman and testicles in a man to produce testosterone. And so sometimes we're looking at that, especially if fertility is an issue. So just know the more data pieces that you have, the bigger and better the pixels are. So it's like an image on a TV. The more data points you have, the better customization that we can do for you. And so when you're converting to estrogen, that range for estrogen, typically 15 to 45 or so, some providers are of the mindset that you don't block it at all. That may be the case, but again, it depends on how you feel with your estrogen. And if it's going too high, you have breast tenderness, you get emotional, then of course we need to address that. So it's customized based on the symptoms that you have, not just a number. And that's the key point. And likewise, dihydrotestosterone, while it may not be high, sometimes that just concentration in the hair follicle can actually cause some thinning. And so it's not necessarily something that it means a high level. But if you have hair side effects, such as too much for women, overgrowth of hair in certain areas for a woman, or thinning for men or for women, then we want to control that metabolism to dihydrotestosterone. And then also with men, think of the prostate. So if you have a high dihydrotestosterone and it's too active, that you potentially can have enlargement of the prostate, and symptoms of that would include some kind of urinary symptoms. You're feeling an urge to go, you can't empty your bladder, a frequency you're getting up at night. So those are all things that would just alert us to maybe we need to look at that dihydrotestosterone level. So we always do baselines of all of these at the beginning. We're following every 3 months, but also adjusting and checking if we need to based on some symptoms or side effects that you may have. So hopefully that was just testosterone metabolism in a nutshell. I'm sure that I've left something out that you might have questions of. So please leave in the comments anything that you would want to know. And I'm always willing to deep dive into anything regenerative medicine or sexual medicine. So let me know. And lastly, don't forget to like and subscribe. Thank you.